This is Duke University.
Long before mixed-race identity became part of casual conversation, there was a phenomenon known as passing. Today, we talk about passing and mixed-race identity with the scholars Marcia Dawkins and Habiba Ibrahim. My name is Mark Anthony Neal, and this is Left of Black.
Yeah. Eric, you're a real life Eric. G for this one. Yeah.
Welcome to Left of Black. I'm your host, Mark Anthony Neal, and we're joined this afternoon by Marcia Alesan Dawkins, who's a professor of communications at the University of Southern California in their Annenberg School. How are you doing this afternoon?
I'm doing well, thanks.
Professor Dawkins is the author of the new book, Clearly Invisible, Racial Passing and the Color of Cultural Identity. So let me start, Marcia, with a story. We were sitting in a production meeting about 10 days ago, discussing, you know, interviews that we're going to have for this year. And of course, we're talking about your book. Catherine, who you've just met, our producer, we're talking about this concept of passing. And Catherine has this perplexed look on her face. She's like, what are you talking about? It's like, well, you know, there's this long history of black folks who pass for white. So let's just start there, right, with the most visible idea of racial passing that we're all familiar with. And the fact that for many white Americans, it's something that, you know, in the early 21st century, they're still very oblivious to on some sort of level.
Thank you for raising the question in that way. As you rightly put it, passing comes to us from a long and many times sad history that we have in our nation. It starts in a racial context during enslavement, when enslaved African Americans would need a written pass in order to get off the plantation to run errands, or if they had a free day, or for whatever purpose they needed to get off. And what many found was that because they had various racial admixtures, many of them, if they dressed appropriately and spoke appropriately and looked appropriately, if they had the right skin color and phenotype, that they could get off the plantation without this written pass. And so that's actually where we get the word and the concept of passing. But that's just the beginning. As you've also rightly said, it comes down to us through segregation, through civil rights, and even into the 21st century when we think about issues of undocumented immigration and technology.
Yeah, you suggested, you know, beginning with the 1990s, we actually witnessed a passing renaissance, you know, what you call new possibilities of passing. Talk about what passing looks like, you know, in 2012 in light of biracial identity, multiracial identity, and as you mentioned throughout the book, a range of other forms of cultural passing that really go against this kind of traditional notion of passing as we've been reading in Harlem Renaissance literature and watching in film for such a long period of time.
Yeah, sure. You know, as passing is manifesting itself now, it's really about taking part of yourself to represent the whole. So let's say a person is Korean and Mexican. Mm-hmm. That person might identify as Korean or Mexican, depending on what the situation is, depending on what the goals and objectives are, depending on whether they need to succeed or survive or find love or find community or a host of other things. Some cases I found in the book, you know, even find people to harm. So passing really takes on that interesting connection when we think about it in terms of multiracial identity. It's less about a lie. I am not this, but I'm pretending to be. I think that's how we generally have thought about passing in the past. But really, as it looks now, it's more about taking a particular part and presenting that part of oneself to the world. So that's how it relates to biracial and multiracial identities today. Beyond that, if I may, passing also really has, you know, manifested itself in terms of age, and that's kind of where I enter the story of passing. Before I knew what racial passing was, I was an age passer. I'm from Queens, New York. I needed to go to a better school, an all-day school in a different neighborhood, and so I had to pass as older and from a different right? So that's one way. And when people are writing in to me, you know, they're telling me all of these things about I'm an age passer too, or I'm a health passer. A lot of people don't want to talk about the abilities and disabilities and health challenges that they have as well. So we really begin to see that though it's a conversation that I think rightly starts with race, it goes into these different areas of human life.
I mean, you mentioned age passing, and immediately, as I'm a big baseball fan, and it immediately made me think of all of the players who come from Spanish-speaking countries in the Caribbean and South America, who all have to pass for younger than they actually are because the teams are unwilling to sign them if you're 21 years old as opposed to if you're 15 years old.
That's absolutely right.
And we rarely think about that kind of activity in terms of passing. And I think one of the great things that your book does is that it really does expand this notion of passing. It makes it much more widespread than historically we thought it was when we thought about it specifically in terms of biracial passing. Talk a little bit about this notion of multiracial passing. Because, you know, on the one hand, we all understand, you know, black and white passing, and you mentioned the example of someone who might be Korean and Mexican, but it can also get much more complicated in terms of how people compartmentalize, if you will, their racial and their ethnic identities.
Absolutely. There's a perfect case in the book that gets at some of this and gets at some of the more menacing aspects of passing in this regard. And so there's the case of this guy named Leo Felton. He's alive right now. This is 21st century. No one ever believes me when I talk about it.
Clayton Bigsby, right?
It's
Dave Chappelle's Clayton Bigsby. Yeah.
Exactly. So, you know, for those of us who are Dave Chappelle fans, we know exactly what that means, right? But like Clayton Bigsby, the real life Leo Felton is a raging white supremacist who also happens to be half Jewish and half black.
Right.
And he's made some very interesting and persuasive, obviously to a point, arguments about what multiracial identities mean and what racial sincerity is all about. Mm-hmm. And he asks the question that really gave me pause, which was this: if race is not biological, if it is a notion of sincerity, like we read in anthropological literature, then why can't I be sincerely a white supremacist despite this background that I have? And why can't I espouse that sincerely? Now, there are a host of reasons why we can give him answers to that question, but I thought it was one that, you know, needed to be reckoned with.
We're joined this afternoon by Professor Marcia Alesan Dawkins, who is Assistant Clinical Professor of Communications at the University of Southern California in the Annenberg School of Communication. She is the author of the new book, Clearly Invisible, Racial Passing and the Color of Cultural Identity, which was just published by the University of Baylor Press. One of the theoretical contributions that you make to this conversation about passing in the book is this notion of passwords, and you run them throughout the context of the book. Talk a little bit about these passwords and what you're hoping to achieve theoretically by introducing them into the discourse.
Absolutely, I'd be happy to. What I really found after talking to people and digging through the literature on passwords were that there were just so many secrets that needed to be unlocked. And in this digital technological age that we live in, you know, it occurred to me one day, I have to enter a password in order to unlock these secrets in my digital identity. And so what if I thought about passing in that way? So that's on a theoretical level, what I hope to do is to unlock some of these secrets that passing has been telling us. And so throughout the book, I go about unlocking those, and they range through a whole host of issues. I start with actually, you know, what passing is and what it does. I get into how people use language in order to pass. So this idea that we've already talked about, how, for instance, when we talk about biracials and multiracials, right, it's not deception necessarily. It's this idea of taking a part of oneself for the whole. I also borrow from the work of Amy Robinson and Charles Morris in talking about the dramatic triangulated theater of passing, right? Yeah. That, you know, we usually think it's just a passer doing his or her own thing, and people either buy into that identity or not. But what Professors Robinson and Morris have shown us is that it's always at least a party of three, that there's the passer, there's the person who believes the identity that the passer is projecting, and then there's this in-group clairvoyant, this person who may know that something's going on backstage, but chooses to either keep the secret or not, for a whole host of reasons that may be only known to that party as well. And so I really tried to take on this role of that in-group clairvoyant as I went through. Tried to see what was really going on behind the scenes.
You mentioned that invoice clairvoyant, and you reference this in the case of what may be the most famous passing case, that of Homer Plessy, and how the detective that's called in to arrest Plessy, right, he's actually the clairvoyant, right, the person who's supposed to make sense of all these kind of intricate lines of identity.
Absolutely. And that's where, you know, again, I wanted to try as much as possible to break away from that traditional notion of passing as just deception all day long, and really say, hey, wait a second, in Homer Plessy's case, this was an act of social protest. This was an act of demonstrating that race and property and money and privilege have all been connected for hundreds of years in our country. And so it was a really fascinating endeavor to undertake.
And you mentioned some aspect of this in the chapter, Passing as Principle, and you're looking at the work of Francis E.W. Harper, and this great quote, you know, what it means to be too white to be black and to be too black to be white. And these folks who choose to pass, who might be light enough to be able to pass into a white world, but very consciously root themselves in black social spaces, and effectively of trying to pass into black out of the principle of wanting to be culturally connected to that community.
Absolutely. I think this is another side of passing that we don't talk about, right? It's always, the common narrative is that it's people passing into the more privileged,
right,
you know, category,
right,
whether that's woman for man, GLBT for straight, or black for white, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But what I found in the research is exactly the opposite, that there have been many situations over time in which people who could have chosen to identify in any of many ways chose to identify, in this case, as black, in order to work for the benefit of racial justice for the entire nation. And so, Frances Harper is just an interesting case of that in many respects herself. Here she is, one of the very first African-American writers. She writes this novel, Iola Leroy, in response to the Plessy decision, because it was just so brutalizing for our nation. And has these twins who are biracial and don't know it, so they grow up thinking they're white, they own slaves, then they get outed, sold into slavery. I mean, it's got all the trappings. And, you know, she shows us how they go through their identity development and makes the case that it is really important for people to acknowledge all of who they are in order to work for social justice.
We're here on Left of Black, and you're watching Marcia Alesan Dawkins, who's a professor of communications at the Annenberg School at University of Southern California, author of the brand new book, Clearly Invisible, Racial Passing and the Color of Cultural Identity, at the University of Baylor Press, or Baylor University Press. One of the most moving chapters in the book is when you discuss the lives of Ellen and William Craft. And I think this is really a chapter that really puts at the forefront the complexity of passing around race, around gender, around class, and the performance of social class in certain kinds of ways. Talk a little bit about the situation of this couple and their desire to get out of slavery and trying to use, for lack of a better way to describe it, the available technologies of the time in order to pass into this different world.
Absolutely. They absolutely used the available technology of the time. I mean, they were such innovators, right? I mean, not only did they, you know, utilize cosmetic technology to turn Ellen, this, you know, biracial, black identifying enslaved woman, into a white wealthy male who could, you know, pass and travel with her property, sadly, her husband, William, right, as her caretaker and slave. There's that aspect to it. There's the aspect that Ellen and William didn't know how to read and write, and they'd have to sign their name. She'd have to sign for them countless times over the course of their trip on the train in public sight from Georgia to Philadelphia. So they developed this very elaborate poultice where, you know, she would hold her arm like this, her whole neck was muffled, these glasses, this hat, and, you know, she would basically feign disability every time someone asked her to write her name. So she gets her name, Mr. William Johnson, her alias's name, written for her through the course of the trip. It was just amazing, you know, when we think about the power of literacy as a form of technology, and that even though this couple couldn't read and write in the standard way that we think about it, they certainly were legible and literate in terms of our culture and our country and what needed to be done. And I think that came through in their story. It's just filled with all of these, you know, secret meetings, and Ellen passes out when someone comes on to her, and then William has to come and rescue her. But then you get William's side of the story, you know, so he gets accused of passing because he puts on a particular hat, and a white guy on the train comes up to him and says, you know, what are you doing wearing that hat, trying to be white? And he didn't know what to do with it. And so, you know, it not only is an amazing story, but gave them fodder to become what I call reality stars in their day, because they went around on the abolitionist circuit internationally telling this story. And they learned how to read and write in English, and then were able to write their story and use that book to raise funds for the cause. So, I mean, when you think about innovators, for me, I think of Ellen and William Craft.
You end the book with this notion of passing as progress. Talk a little bit about that. Unpack that idea for us.
Sure. That comes at the end of this book, where I've gone through all of the stories that we've talked about and said, okay, you know, what do we do from here? We've got this amazing innovative side to passing with Ellen and William Craft. We've got this, public policy protest-oriented side with Homer Plessy. We've got this idea of, you know, acknowledging all of who you are all the time from Frances Harper and her characters. And then we've got Leo Felton, who we may not know what. So, you know, you get this whole story, or at least for me, I got this whole story of passing out in front of me, and I thought, okay, what happens now? How do we go and move toward progress, toward racial progress, gender progress, ethnic progress, any kind of progress you can imagine? And can passing be a part of the story? And I think the answer is yes and no. Yes, because we need to tell the whole story of passing so that we understand what people are going through, so we can understand why different groups react in different ways to statements that they hear or to events that are reported and to the experiences of their lives, and also to understand that people are still passing every day. But no, insofar as we don't use that knowledge to inform our larger public policy choices, right? That we just still consider passing to be an individual mandate as opposed to maybe a call that we have to do some changing in our country.
Yeah. What's next for you, Professor Dawkins?
Actually, I'm very excited. I'm going to take this all one step further and talk about my favorite passer, race, age, and everything else. Got a book coming out in a few months called Eminem, the Real Slim Shady with Prager Press that takes a look at these issues from his perspective.
Well, thank you for joining us this afternoon. We've been joined this afternoon on Left to Black by Professor Marcia Alesan Dawkins, who is Assistant Clinical Professor of Communications at the University of Southern California in their Annenberg School. She's the author of the new book, Clearly Invisible, Racial Passing and the Color of Cultural Identity. Thank you again for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you so much for having me. It's really been an honor.
Thank you. Good afternoon and welcome to Left to Black. I am your host, Mark Anthony Neal, and we are joined this afternoon by Professor Habiba Ibrahim, who is a professor of English at the University of Washington in Seattle and the author of the brand new book, Troubling the Family, The Promise of Personhood and the Rise of Multiculturalism, published by the University of Minnesota Press. How are you doing today, Habiba?
I'm well. Thank you, Mark. How are you?
I'm doing well, and I feel like I've known this project since its inception.
Yeah, that's not wrong. I think you have.
So I'm so excited to kind of see it into the world. And the timing of it now, even more so that when you began this project as your dissertation some years ago, it's even more resonant now, if only because of the visibility and popularity, notoriety, if you will, of figures like Tiger Woods, mm-hmm. and Barack Obama, and I guess we could throw Maya Rudolph into that right. mix. We live in a thoroughly mixed race and multiracial society, and I think your book really taps into trying to unpack the dynamics of that. So if you can talk a little bit about your interest in this subject matter and what kind of things you were hoping to achieve with the publication of the book.
Yes, thank you. It's true that this is a moment where we have a number of prominent figures who are mixed race, and in terms of our racial discourse, mixed racialism is fairly par for the course, etc. My interest with regard to the topic of the cultural politics of multiracialism, the reason why I wanted to write this book was because of a sort of provocation that I couldn't find answers for immediately. And this was, for me, the reason why during what seemed to me like the 1990s seemed for me like a moment where the sort of prominence of multiracialism blew up, that suddenly multiracial politics became salient in a way that I hadn't seen historically. And so we know that you know, blackness, as it's been configured in terms of U.S. logics of race, have been mixed. We refer to this mixture with regard to the one drop rule, for instance, or the rule of hypodescent. And so the question that really became a provocation for me is, why was it that during the 1990s, a particular multiracial movement emerged? What were its preconditions? What exactly happened during that particular moment that made us collectively interested and captivated and aware of a sort of distinctive multiracial identity, distinctive from other modes of racial formation?
Yeah, it's interesting because, you know, much of this, the work that you do is framed around this unique 30-year period. The Loving case in 1967 and the decision in 1997 to rethink how we were going to represent mixed race or multiracial identity in terms of the 2000 census. And, right. and part of what you argue is that what you see really as combatants during this period of time is blackness versus multiculturalism, right? Where blackness in some ways becomes the stand-in or even the symbol for multiracialism in the United States, suddenly these things are taking on two very different dynamics and in some ways are at war, initially over the body of Eldrick Woods, right? But could be articulated in many different, in different ways. So talk a little bit about this dynamic between blackness versus multiculturalism.
Right, thank you. Yeah, well, it seems like, especially during, well, Tiger Woods is one example of how this tension played out. With regard to how he became meaningful with regard to black community as the first to, you know, win the Augusta tournament. I mean, to win that PGA title was a huge accomplishment for African-American identity and African-American community, et cetera. It seemed as if it was another example of how one of us does something exceptional and allows us to celebrate that accomplishment collectively. At the same time, because it so happened that historic win coincided with the sort of burgeoning attempt to get a multiracial category on the census. This is to say that 1997 is important for me because of those two events, occurrences. On the one hand, we have the sort of rise of multiracialism via Tiger Woods' prominence. He becomes not only a multiracial figure, but a black figure, right? I mean, he becomes someone who is heir to the legacy of you know, Jackie Robinson, right?
Lee Elder, right? They were all
exactly. I mean, we can understand him in terms of a lineage of black male athleticism, and so he fits into a sort of chronology with regard to how we speak about black exceptionalism. It seems as if that logic often follows a sort of genealogy, right? So this is to say that, you know, Jackie Robinson sort of begets Tiger Woods, et cetera. there's a sort of kinship narrative with regard to how we understand who comes before whom. So we as a black community feel very much entrenched in that sort of dialogue of family, right? It's about who our kin are. So to some degree, we were invested in thinking of him as our, as ours, right? You can sort of think of the Dave Chappelle bit where there's that kind of vying over Tiger Woods with regard to racialism.
The racial draft, right? Yeah.
Right, exactly. Like, we're you know, who's going to get, you know, some stake here. And that, I think, was to some degree what he played it out in a way that allowed us to sort of think about this, you know, not spoken of tension. We know that blackness has been mixed in the U.S. context, right? That there, that's not a contradiction. And yet, the stakes became one of thinking about the future of blackness if we were to recognize mixedness. So when it came about that in 1997, same year Tiger Woods wins the PGA tournament, we have the Office of Management and Budget allowing for a new way of categorizing
race. Category, yeah, right.
To choose one or more, which is a way for multiracial subjects to, you know, self-identify in ways that weren't possible according to the state previously. So what the problem was with this, with regard to some constituencies in traditional Black civil rights organizations, the NAACP, for instance, and the Urban League, were two organizations who represented a kind of concern during the senatorial conversations with regard to changing the census. And their concern was that changing the census so that Black folks, for all intents and purposes, can identify as mixed, for all intents and purposes, would undercut Black constituency. That it's not so much, when we think about the process of identification, we're not only thinking about, you know, what this means for personhood, what it means for one to self-recognize in all of the ways that we want to be understood publicly. The consequences are also political, and right. For that reason, they also have a lot to do with the way resources are redistributed, right. Or how, you know, districts are kind of limed, et cetera. And so this was the concern of traditional civil rights organizations, is that with regard to the appearance of mixedness, how can we prevent the undercutting of traditional racialized communities for the sake of preserving traditional civil rights agendas?
It becomes a literal erosion of Black political power, right? At least that was the fear. And particularly because it gives individuals, the person, if you will, the opportunities to opt out of Blackness if they so choose, right? And this is exactly, of course, what Tiger does, you know, sitting, as you describe it, you know, Oprah Winfrey's studio and set becomes a vestibule, right? The place where you look through the door to find out who exactly is coming in. And so, you know, Tiger is sitting there in the vestibule and decides to opt out of Blackness and opt into Calabasianness, right? Whatever that was supposed to be at the time.
Calabasian, right. Yes, and that was quite a firestorm, right? It at least produced one. But yes, what I'm interested in with regard to that particular moment has to do with where this disclosure happened. Yeah. It wasn't a secret that Tiger identified as multiracial. I mean, right. He wasn't secretive about who his mother was. He wasn't secretive about his own self-identification. I think what happened was, after he wins, historically, he gives this sort of speech where he acknowledges, you know, all of those golfers who couldn't, you know, break the color line in the manner that he had.
Charlie Sifford, Lee Elder, who we mentioned earlier, right? All these cats who came before him, yeah.
That's right. And he acknowledges them and thanks them for paving the way. And so he's producing a kind of very familiar narrative of kinship with regard to racialism, right? That if racialism often takes the logic of kinship, we understood very much what he was attempting to write himself into racially. Right. So we had that moment. But then when he gets on Oprah Winfrey's program, he discloses something that we should have known very well, but does so in a way that seems to not just undercut what we had hoped he would say, right? That we would hope that he would sort of, you know, reproduce that sort of narrative of race as kinship. He cuts himself off not only from Blackness, but from any sort of historical, any sort of historical mode that we have readily accessible to understand his racialized, right. You know, identity, right? So Coblen Asian as a term is really idiosyncratic. It's not to anybody but Tiger, right?
He made it up, right? It's literally so, right.
Nobody else can use it, really, right? I mean, you know, it's so it seems not only like he was cutting himself off from Black community, which of course many people understood him to be doing at that moment, but it seemed as if he was sort of, relinquishing any narrative of racialization as community in order to create a version of selfhood and personhood
in
public that, that was almost irrespective of race, even though it named race explicitly.
And it's interesting because in some ways it makes him literally a unique brand, right?
Yeah.
It makes him a very, very unique brand and no one else can actually share in what he represents in that case.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, we can share in what he seems to be, which is a figure of transcendence. We can share in what we imagine is his capability to speak across racial, ethnic lines because he's not adherent to any particular, historical, lineage, right? I mean, to some degree, that notion of transcendence and almost being post-racial is something that becomes an enticement at the end of the 20th century. And I think that that's one that he was able to offer, as a sort of enticing possibility for how each of us might, to some degree, have our own idiosyncrasies recognized in public.
Yeah. Eric, you're a real IG for this one. Yeah. All black everything. All black, you know. All black in the name of all my black heroes. All black everything. All black polos. All black medallions, yeah. All black, you know, say. All black everything. All black, you know. All black in the name of all my black heroes.